would mention that you can use radiation to also treat breast cancer. And the last modality that you would use would be drugs. And so today we'll start with the agents that are used to treat breast cancer. I've listed some of the groups that are used, there are more, and I will get to here. But today we will start with the PARP inhibitors. ADP ribose polymerase inhibitors. The parts that are available are the ones I've listed here, the veliparib all the way to olaparib. They all end in parib, of course. And the agents that we will use as the representative agent will be your olaparib. And for the pharmacology, as usual, we take a representative drug and we discuss the pharmacology of it. And we also start with the mechanism of action of the drug. And so olaparib works, of course, by inhibiting PARP. And what does PARP do? That enzyme is involved in control of your DNA transcription. It is also involved in preventing DNA damage, causing DNA damage. So it's involved in your breakage of DNA damage. And it is also involved in resealing DNA that has been damaged. And so, one last thing, of course, would be overall cellular growth. Now, all these things will be affected by that enzyme in a rather negative way. If you inhibit that enzyme, in other words, if you inhibit the PARP, you'll be getting less transcription of DNA, you'll be getting more damage of the cell, and you'll be getting less resealing, so the DNA does not come back together. And if you don't reseal DNA, of course, that can lead to cellular death. And of course, cell growth, if you inhibit that PARP, you'll be decreasing cellular growth of the cancer cells. So this mechanism of action, once it inhibits that enzyme, you get all these negative effects in the cancer cell. So the cancer cell can be basically destroyed or its growth inhibited. So that's how all your PARP inhibitors would work. And then, of course, we get to the admin of the drug. For olaparib, we know that it is a drug that is administered orally. That's the route of administration. It comes in tablets, and the tablets are in 50 milligram increments. You know, so you have your 50, 100, and 150 milligrams. So it comes in 50 milligram increments. And we usually start the initial dose of olaparib with 300 milligrams PO on a BID basis. Okay. And the patient should be advised not to use grapefruit juice. Not grapes, but grapefruit juice. No grapefruit juice, because if you do, you increase the likelihood of getting toxicity from that drug. There's also a type of orange or oranges that you call Seville oranges, and those should not be administered concurrently, or those should not be ingested concurrently with your olaparib, again, to prevent accumulation and toxicity of that drug. In terms of its half-life, its half-life is about 15 hours, so that fits in with the BID administration. And the plasma protein binding of the drug is about 85%. Let's start with that. And if we look at its metabolism, it will be metabolized by your 3A4 as well as your 2B6. So it can be metabolized by 3A4 and 2B6. Even though it's a substrate for 3A4, it can also stimulate 3A4 as well as inhibit 3A4. So it does all of those with your 3A4. And then it can undergo conjugation. And so you can have both sulfate and your glucuronide conjugation for that olaparib. And in terms of the excretion, the drug is about equal in terms of feces, that is fecal excretion, as well as your urinary excretion. It's right about 44% and 42% for your urinary excretion. So that's the ADMA for your olaparib. And the next thing we normally talk about is the indication of your olaparib or the chosen drug. And the indication for olaparib will include, of course, breast cancer. That's what we are discussing here. So it can be used for breast cancer. It can be used for ovarian cancer. And it is also used for prostate cancer. Okay. And we can also use it for pancreatic cancer. So it can be used for all of those. The issue or the main point is that your olaparib has to be used after regular chemo has been used. Okay. And so in the case of your breast cancer, we say that it is used for an advanced breast cancer or for a metastatic breast cancer. And the metastatic breast cancer, okay, by advanced here, I'm referring to like a stage 3 breast cancer, where you have had the involvement of, let's say, the chest wall. your pectoralis muscles, you know, major, minor, and that. And some auxiliary nerves, but it has not gone to a long distance part of the body. Okay. And then, of course, metastatic would be your stage 4 breast cancer. So it can be used there. Whether the breast cancer is a germline, germline metastatic breast cancer, which would mean familial, that is the one that was passed down, or whether it is a somatic metastatic breast cancer. And the key point though is that you would use orthotic to treat the breast cancer, like I said, after you've tried something else, or your regular breast cancer drugs or chemotherapy. Now, the breast cancer, though, has to have, you can say ER, can be ER positive. In fact, you can see sometimes written as hormone receptor positive. And it has to be HER2 negative. So it is used for ER positive or HR positive, then HER or HER2 negative, germ MBC or somatic MBC. So somatic would be the one that just developed spontaneously. It's not passed down through the germline. So that's when you can use your and the same thing with ovarian, prostate, and pancreas. So that's what you use the drug for. And how do you know if the cancer is receptor positive, that is ER or HR? One would conduct what is called IHC. That's immunohistochemistry. That is actually a staining method that will show your receptor positive cells of that breast cancer. And then one would do what is called an ORED scoring. And that will go from 0 to 8. So if you get an ORED score of 4 and above, then you have a good prognosis, which basically means that you have a lot of your receptor positive breast cancer. And so you do the IHC to see the ones that are stained, and then you score the ones that are stained through that ORED mechanism. And the higher it is, the better the prognosis in the management of that breast cancer. Now, the adverse effects that one can see with your PARP inhibitors using olaparib as the example. Most of the common adverse effects of olaparib are GI related. So you have your usual nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, and then it can produce some anorexia. And one can see some sores around the mouth. Okay, and then dysgeusia can be present, and dyspepsia. So many of them are GI related. But then the drug can produce hypomagnesemia. That's also very common with this drug. And then you can have things related to the muscles, fatigue, then myalgia and arthralgia. Those can be present with the drug. And then you have URIs, the upper respiratory tract infections that can also be seen commonly with the use of this agent. But more serious conditions that can result from the use of olaparib would include clotting. It can produce pulmonary embolism. It can also cause your venous thromboembolism, VTE. Venous thromboembolism can be seen with that agent. Just like we mentioned, many drugs that are used to treat cancer can also cause some form of cancer. And so this drug has been known to produce leukemia, acute myelogenous leukemia, AML. It is one of the adverse effects, serious adverse effects of your olaparib. And lastly, it can produce myelodysplastic syndrome. So if you say myelo, of course you're talking about your own myelo stuff. So MDS can result from the use of olaparib. All right, so that's what we have for your PARP inhibitors. And we used olaparib as a representative agent for that group. And the next group you see there would be your CDK inhibitors. And for the CDK inhibitors, we're talking about cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitors. And the drugs that are used here for breast cancer will be the ones that would inhibit CD4K4 and 6. So they're basically very selective and specific for that condition. So the one we will take as the representative agent will be Dr. Abrams. We will have, of course, Piscali, which is another member of that agent. But we'll take the Abrams or palbociclib. again, like we did with the PARP, using that specific agent, we look at the mechanism of action. There is a protein that is called retinoblastoma. Retinoblastoma protein. This is the protein that actually controls the movement of a G1 cell into an S phase. That is, during cellular division, a G1 cell will go to the S phase, the synthetic phase, if you will. And the conversion or the movement into the S phase is what is influenced by your CDK4 and 6. So you have a specific point at which these drugs can work. Now, for that conversion to take place, you have to activate the retinoblastoma protein. And the way you activate that, and by activation, we're talking about phosphorylation. And if you say phosphorylation, you know we'll be talking about kinases. So when you say cyclin dependent, you know, kinase. You know, a kinase phosphorylates. So by phosphorylation, we're talking about activation. So your CDK would phosphorylate this retinoblastoma protein, and that's what activates or makes that cell cycle begin from G1 to S. So that's how this cyclin-dependent agents work. So they can inhibit the phosphorylation of retinoblastoma protein, they can inhibit the movement of the G1 to an S phase during cellular division. So that's the mechanism of action. And if we look at the ADME or your ABRAS, we know that it is also administered orally. It comes like in the 25 milligram increments. So you have 75 milligrams, then you have 100, and then you have 125 milligrams. Even though 125 milligrams is the highest strength, that is actually what you start therapy with also. It's the 125 milligrams that would be administered on a daily basis, so it's a QD administration. And just like your PARP inhibitor, that we did, you know, on a PARP, the ABRAS should not be administered concurrently with grapefruit juice. So you don't want to use grapefruit juice concurrently with it to prevent food into toxicity. You don't want to give it concurrently with pomegranate either. Okay, so you can get toxicity. If you give it with St. John's wort, then you can actually decrease the effectiveness of your ABRAS. Okay, so you give it with pomegranate, you give it with grapefruit juice and all that, you can see toxicity. If you give it with St. John's wort, you can actually see a decrease in its effectiveness. The other thing is pregnancy. ABRAS is not supposed to be used when you are pregnant or even planning to get pregnant. And it's not supposed to be used in a patient who is breastfeeding. So those are all patient information that you can deliver. Okay. So that's in terms of the adenine or the administration of the drug. In terms of the half-life of the drug is about 24 to 34 hours, and hence the once-a-day administration. Okay. The plasma protein binding for that drug is also about 85%. You know, the other one is just 82, 25, but this is 85, definitely. Okay, the excretion, or maybe we should do metabolism first. Metabolism is also by 3A4. And whenever you have a drug that is metabolized by 3A4, you always have to think of drug-to-drug interactions involving that drug. Drugs that stimulate 3A4, and drugs that will inhibit 3A4. So in terms of excretion, in this case, it is primarily through the feces. So you don't have to worry about renal dysfunction when using Abrams, and it's about, we'll round up the numbers, it's about 74% through the feces and about 17% through the urine. Okay. So that's the ADMA for that agent. Now, the indications, your Abrams is used for the management, again, of your advanced stage breast cancer, and also for your metastatic breast cancer. That is, again, ER positive, but HER2 negative. But in this situation, Abrams can be used before the patient has been exposed to any cancer chemotherapeutic agent. Okay. If you use it in a patient that has not been exposed to any chemo, then you would usually administer it concurrently with an aromatase inhibitor. And the ones that are often used, naltrexone, which of course we do our Remedex. So one can use that. One can also use letrozole. Or one can use aromacin. Okay. Anastrozole and letrozole are aromatase inhibitors type 2. And your aromacin is a type 1. So, if you use Arimidex, you have to use 1 milligram along with your Abrams. If you use letrozole, you use 2.5 milligrams. If you use aromacin, you use 25 milligrams of that. And so those can be given along with your Abrams. What one normally does is days 1 to 21 of the month, you use a combination. That is the Abrams plus the aromatase inhibitor. And then from days 22 to 28, you just use the aromatase inhibitor only. Okay, so days 1 to 21, both 22 to 28 days of the month, then you just use the aromatase inhibitor only. Now, if the patient had your HR positive, ER negative, metastatic breast cancer, or your stage 3 breast cancer, and had been exposed to chemotherapy before, then you can use the drug of fulvestrant, which is your Faslodex. So with that prior chemotherapy, you use aromatase inhibitors. With prior chemotherapy, you use Faslodex along with your Abrax. And the Faslodex is injected intramuscularly. You get 500 milligrams IM. And the way you use Faslodex with Abrax, on days 1 to 21, you give Abrax alone. And then days 22 to 28, well, it will actually be longer than that. But at the end of the 21 days, you now introduce Faslodex. And Faslodex will be administered 500 milligrams IM, and that will be given every 2 weeks. It will be given every 2 weeks for 3 doses. And from that point on, then your Faslodex will be given once a month, that is every 4 weeks. So again, Abrax will be given daily for the first 21 days. And following that, you will give Faslodex, you know, every 2 weeks for just 3 doses. After that, then it will be one every 4 weeks. So that's how it is used for managing breast cancer. If
so, the previous one where we talked about no exposure to chemotherapy, do you continue? So we did the day 1 to 21 and then 22 to 28. Do you repeat the cycle the next month?
Yeah. That's the whole month thing. So on day 1 to 21 of the following month, it will be the same. Yeah, and then day 22 to 28 use aromatics. And the site that is most often used for Faslodex is the dairy. So you give it IM. Gluteus maximus. So that's indication for the Faslodex. And in terms of the adverse effects, neutropenia is a major adverse effect of Abrax. It is actually the TLT for Abrax. And then, of course, it produces a lot of GI-related adverse effects also. Mouth sores, loss of appetite, nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, things like that. And then it can give you some weight loss. And the other major organ that it affects is the pulmonary system. You get an inflammation of the lungs, and you get what is called scarring of the lungs. Okay. so the patient would, of course, experience difficulty in breathing, so shortness of breath would actually be there. They would feel very weak also, you know, probably because they're not eating and they are not getting oxygenated blood into the system. So you can see how it goes with difference. And then just like your PARP inhibitors, Abrams can also produce clots. Okay, so you can have thrombosis and then or thromboembolism using these agents. All right. Your HER2 inhibitors, of course, talking about trastuzumab. Everyone knows about, and then pertuzumab. And we can also talk about the mirvetuximab. It's a little different there. The difference between mirvetuximab and pertuzumab is the FC, that is the crystallizable fraction of that antibody. Then you have tucatuzumab. And by this, well, if you look at an antibody, of course, you will have those two. So this is your normal antibody that will have a PARP fragment and that will have an FC fragment. The PARP fragment just means antigen binding fragment. And of course the FC is the crystallizable fragment. The FC fragment determines the kinetics of your antibody, where it goes, what temperature it can withstand, things like that. So in the case of mirvetuximab, the FC fragment that was present in your pertuzumab has been modified such that it can have, or it can bind to your NK cells, natural killer cells. So it's been modified such that it can bind to natural killer cells. So if you have the antigen over here, the antigen binding fragment, and you have your natural killer cells over here, you have basically brought together your natural killer cells that can kill off the antigen. That is sometimes referred to as the ADCC mechanism by which antibodies work. That's just one of the mechanisms by which they work, which just means antigen-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity. Antigen-dependent cell-mediated cytotoxicity. So that's how your mirvetuximab works. That's why it's a little different from your pertuzumab. But anyway, those HER2 inhibitors will be used for an advanced breast cancer that has or that is HER2 positive, not negative. Okay? So the breast cancer cells will be HER2 positive. that's where your HER2 inhibitors would actually be used. Very effective. And we've gone over different combinations that you can have with your trastuzumab. Sometimes you see it combined with pertuzumab. Sometimes you can see it combined with vinorelbine. Sometimes with anastrozole. Sometimes with docetaxel and so on. Okay. So, you know your HER2 antagonists. One of the classes for the group. Let me just go to number 8. Yes.
For the Margenza, do you need it?
For which one?
The Margenza? The Do you need it bound for the FC region, and it pretty much promotes the natural killer cells that will produce the side effects? Is it still considered an inhibitor, or is it kind of, you know, weird?
It's still considered a HER2 inhibitor, and that's why you can say, I think you see the handout. You see that it's listed on the HER2 inhibitors and also on the other monoclonal antibodies.
So it's the FC promoter, but it hurts the paper.
Right, it's a HER2, yeah. But it works by ADCC. Yeah. And so since we're talking about that, we can go to this one that we listed as number 8, other monoclonal antibodies, because your HER2 inhibitors are mAbs. They are monoclonal antibodies. Okay, so the others can be your PD-1 inhibitors, and then of course your PD-1 inhibitors. And the two examples we gave there were pembrolizumab. So your Keytruda will be one of the other monoclonal antibodies that you can use to treat breast cancer. And then you have your Tecentriq, which can also be used. Your programmed cell death protein is actually considered a checkpoint protein. Which basically means that it can switch off the activities of your T cells, particularly T cytotoxic cells. That's how your body protects the normal cells against the activities of your immune system. In other words, if the PD-1, which is actually a CD, that is a cluster differentiation protein, as 279, CD279, like when you say CD4 or CD8, your cells, T cells, PD-1 is actually a CD279. And when it is complexed with a ligand, then the switch can be turned to off. And that's how that's why your T cells will not attack your normal cell. And so if you want to prevent, let's say, arthritis, which we know now is immune related, then your PD will bind with the ligand, and that will prevent your T cell from attacking your normal cell, so you don't get that autoimmune disease. And that's what cancer cells do. Cancer cells elaborate a lot of PD-L1. So that way they complex with the PD and turn off your immune system so that the immune system will not attack the cancer cells. That's what we do. And so you would want an inhibitor of this to turn on your immune system so that your T cytotoxic cells can then attack the cancer cells. So that's the mechanism by which those other mice will produce the effect that we want. Well, we will start on the RTK and the P3 over here next time, but we can rule out some of these that we've already discussed in Polar 3, alkylate agents, then your methotrexate derivatives, then your 5-FU derivatives. We talked about all of those in Polar 3, so we can go to pick those. Receptor tyrosine kinase next time.
But passing those out, do you mean that we won't be tested on that, or if we just don't need to review it?
It will always be tested on that. But it just means that no, we will not go over those. We already have those, so that will be tested.
But it's almost.
It's just something you do. It won't test you. Any other question? All right. We'll start with receptor tyrosine kinase next time. And then go to your PI3 kit.